For hundreds of years, gypsies and travellers have called the British Isles their home.
There's five, maybe six generations of my family living on the road.
Battling to keep their unique way of life. And it's not been an easy ride.
That's what you get, idiots like that.
For centuries, they've locked horns with the outside world.
I want to hear this.
But why?
They drive through the town very fast and reckless.
Are they going to damage my property? There's going to be, like, horse poo everywhere.
Hey, boys, don't block the road up.
What are they saying?
They're saying, what a load of bollocks.
Good girl.
When they see us walking, they'll be like, oh, well, she's a traveller, well, we shouldn't really be here.
And they wonder why we can't get on with the settler people, why we feel a bit wary of them.
Gypsies and travellers live by an ancient code.
A woman's place basically is at home, isn't it, in our community.
Following traditions that some view with suspicion.
Watch yourself, my sweetheart, for somebody called Dennis.
And rules that some see as barbaric.
It's a little bit medieval, but if it's not broke, don't fix it.
Some people might call it cruel, but this is how we live off the land.
We'll reveal what goes on inside their secret world.
I'm in heaven!
What more could you ask for on a day like this?
And see how by clinging to age-old values...
That's what you call some here, and that's heavy too. All Romani gypsies want that on their daughters.
We are who we are and we can't change that.
Come hell or high water...
Gypsy right! Romani right!
They're here to stay.
All gypsies take over.
We're still here. Can't get rid of us yet.
In Dorset, Romani Gypsy Marie is setting out on an important mission to celebrate her travelling heritage.
What these, you always keep larding them to stop them rusting. You know, you go up a lane, just light a fire, take a bit of bacon with you, a few eggs, sausages, and just put it on and fry it. And then you've got your meal, would you? I was born on the road, and I'm proud to be born on the road. And from a baby, I've knew nothing any difference.
Marie's leaving her semi-detached house to drive deep into the countryside. She's joining her brother, Leon.
Off we go. Come on, Alfie.
On a more traditional mode of transport.
This is where Mum used to stop, look, Levi. And Granny used to cut all her sticks out of there when she used to stop here.
Marie and Leon were raised in wagons on the road. Though they both now live in houses, they're planning to celebrate their nomadic childhood.
Dad used to put a swing up there for us to play on the tree. And Dad used to get all his sticks. We'd make all the pegs here for the steam fair, to go to the steam fair and sail. My parents loved travelling on the road. That was their life. Travelling to fair, earning a living on the road. That was the most important thing to my mum and dad. Good boy.
They're camping out at a spot that used to be a regular home.
That brings back a lot of memories. Because I can see Mum's wagon there now, just looking at me, and I can see Mum and Dad sat round the fire, so plain as day. They loved it here. Lovely wood to start a fire. We was lucky, really. This was here.
Marie and Leon's parents both recently passed away. This evening, they'll honour their memory with a special gypsy ritual.
I'm burning Dad's towel, what he used to use.
How are you?
Yeah, because they come here, it'd be nice to have something here that belonged to them, just to burn, wouldn't it?
I think it's a great spot to do it.
Yeah. Burning is a traveller's culture thing. They wouldn't like me to box it up and take it to a second-hand shop because gypsies wouldn't like somebody else wearing my mum and dad's stuff.
The gypsy tradition of burning the possessions of loved ones goes back through the ages and is meant as a sign of respect to the deceased. It's also thought by some to ensure that the living don't catch contamination from evil spirits, known as marime.
It dates back for generations, you know, for centuries. If somebody died in a caravan, you would burn it. It wouldn't mean if it was worth £20,000, you still burn it.
Leon's sons, Jamie and Leon Jr., who work in the building trade, and Levi, who is still at school, are joining them for this evening's ceremony.
There'll be rubbers around the fire tonight for sure.
Yeah, that's right.
I think it's just out of respect and, you know, the love we had for me nan and granddad.
Yeah.
Marie's also brought her 29-year-old daughter, Charmaine.
This spot, I'm so happy it's still open, because Dad's been coming here for, must have been 70 years, travelling on this spot, my mum and Dad, up and down with wagons.
But being close to a busy road, they're worried that some more unsavoury history may also repeat itself.
I'm pretty sure tonight somebody will go past, either shout or maybe lob something. Because some will even drive cars at you, you know, like when I'm coming along. Some people do, you know. You've got to be very keeping, Levi.
You'll get the local people going around saying, you know, to their mate, there's gypsies stopped down the road, look, you know, keep an eye on your stuff.
Automatically they think, gypsies, stealing, pinching, poaching. You know, straight away.
And there is some that does do it, don't get me wrong. But not every gypsy does it.
Leon hopes local disapproval doesn't disrupt their ritual and tarnish the sacred burning of his parents' possessions.
This trip could be ruined by other people. They could be shouting a lot of abuse.
They could do anything. Let your horse go. It can come with anywhere. It can come at any time of night. You just never know when it's coming. A click of a finger will wake me up. I can assure you that.
Burn.
In Cambridgeshire, gypsy cage fighter Tony the Rhino Giles is taking on a new and daunting challenge.
So this is the new project. This is my first time at building my... Looks like a scene out of a horror film.
He snapped up an investment property in the countryside that definitely qualifies as a fixer-upper.
Imagine this at a new two-storey building, the size of this. This is all being grabbed and took away.
Tony's built a successful career, both as a fighter and as a fair play man, organising bare-knuckle fights to settle disputes between gypsies.
I've been in the fight game since the age of 6. Basically done it my whole life. That's a long time. I even sit and think to myself, now how have I got this far? But I have and I'm here. Break him up.
But being in the middle of violent underworld feuds has put Rhino's own life in danger.
I live in one of the nicest parts of Surrey. Beautiful there, the Queen's Back Garden that I jog round every morning, and then by the time the afternoon, yeah, we're wiping blood off from T-shirts. And I seem to be in the mix of it all the time.
Tony's doing up the property as an inheritance for his son.
Come on, Tone!
To escape the dangers that he's grown up with.
Oh, can't wait.
We're having a fire, boy.
It's getting a lot more rougher, and it's getting a lot more shootings, stabbings, you know. It never used to be like that. Now it's a frequent thing, you know.
Tony also wants 13-year-old little Tony to learn the skills expected of a gypsy man.
Brought my son today to teach him that in life you have to work to get on. He's got my cousin every morning tapping on doors and selling compost, trying to pound a bag.
In gypsy culture, manual labour is often seen as more important than education. And many gypsy boys are encouraged to leave school early and go to work in established family trades.
Chuck a few more bricks there, Tone, quickly, and I'll grab a few bits of this.
Little Tony left school aged 11 and has his own big ambitions.
I want to be like my dad. I want to follow in his footsteps, become a fighter one day. But I've got quite a lot to learn till that day comes.
Along with the security of owning his own property, Tony wants his son to enjoy a happier childhood than he did.
Well, watch this, Tone, and I shall start fire. This is my trademark. You know, my dad died when I was young. I had no one to put me in the right direction. So that's why I sort of went in the wrong one.
When I was 8 years of age, I watched my uncle get shot, and he was killed, and I was literally stood behind him, and he died like in front of me.
But it didn't break me, it made me. So I wouldn't like him to go through it. So they, yeah, as long as there's breath in my body, he's not going to be going down that pathway.
But today, he's set his son some grueling tasks to prove that he's got what it takes to succeed in life.
Look at this. We look at this like training time, don't we, son? Come on. Just grab them pieces of holly around there. Get them on that fire, please, son.
How's he doing with the work?
He's OK. He starts OK. It's just midway time, he sort of starts hiding and then making the noises, you know?
Do you think that compared to maybe the older generations that you lot have it easier now?
Yeah, definitely. As years have gone on, things have changed, haven't they?
You learn a lot from your dad.
Yeah. He's got sank up his sleeve every time. Sank no and show me.
Little Tony has to help clear logs and debris from every nook and cranny of the property.
Hold your hand there, foot round. That's it. If you could pass me them big bits over, and I'll chuck them down, yeah?
I'll chuck your apples over.
So you got to understand, Tony, everything that you're doing here, I know it seems like you don't have to do it, yeah, but later on in life, you're going to know what to do, aren't you? So you don't have to rely on anyone. Might pull that up, Tom. That bit there, that's it. A little bit of hard work don't hurt anyone. Listen, always hold the centre. Never hold the sides, always hold the centre.
You're holding the sides.
Hold the middle.
Now he's in the swing of life on a building site, it's time for Tony's toughest test.
If I leave here and you're working, I want to at least know that you're not going to chop your arm off, your leg off, or anything.
He has to chop up the cleared logs using a chainsaw.
Because when you get older, you've got to remember, yeah? There's going to be a time when you're going to have to cut a tree down or maybe use one of these, yeah? And I'm not going to be there, so the last thing I'd like to see you do is hurt yourself. They're dangerous. You could kill a cut through an archery quite easily. If you don't pull the top of the blade runs round, yeah? So if you're holding it there, you don't even know it's chopping into you.
Dad's just trying to teach me the importance of hard work. Chainsaw, well, I'll do it when I get older, probably. Like, I might have to cut my own tree down or whatever it is. So don't chop my leg off.
Stop. Coming up, an emotional ritual for Marie and Leon.
They'll always be part of my life to the day I die.
But will their worst fears come true?
Leon, there's a car parked up here.
She's turning around.
Yeah, we're right. Right, Marie, are you getting ready?
God bless you, man.
And a family hunting trip for Percy and Rachel.
It's important to catch anything because we need it.
In the northeast of England, travelling man Diamond Jackson is making a pilgrimage to a place synonymous with his culture.
I've been coming up to Appleby since I was about, well, probably before I was five.
But we came every year with my father. It's like Mecca to the travelling community.
Diamond hails from a long line of English travellers in the Bradford area. Aged five, he went to work in scrap metal, learning the family trade rather than going to school. Diamond's early years were spent touring the country fairs, selling wares from a bow-top wagon. And no occasion was more important than Appleby.
I was brought up in and around Yorkshire. There's no better than Yorkshire. My father used to take us on the road when we were children, up to Appleby Fair and that, and it's always been a fascination. And we used to get threepence a day in them days, which is 2p, and we used to go out for a day and spend it.
But for Diamond, this is no ordinary visit, as unwanted circumstances have brought him to this special place.
I got diagnosed with terminal cancer 2 years ago, but I'm still here 2 years on. I've always been positive. If I get bad news, I keep strong and keep positive.
You should always be proud of being what you are and where you come from. I won't swap my life for anything.
As his final days approach, Diamond's come to Appleby to experience one travelling rite of passage that's eluded him so far.
I come from a travelling background, but to be honest with you, I've never been on a horse and I'm not afraid of them, but I've never actually been on them, been on horses and broke them in a rope like that.
It's on my wish list to get on a horse and have a little ride. It's on my bucket list before I go.
Horses have been part of travellers' life since time begun. This is one of the things I want to do in the last chapter of my life, get back into a bit of horse riding.
Since the 1600s, gypsies and travellers have gathered at Appleby once a year for the world-famous horse fair.
We're on for a deal, sir.
Which attracts 30,000 visitors. During the pandemic of 2020, the fair was cancelled, but six people still attended due to a traveller belief that it would be lost forever if it didn't go ahead. Before his horse ride, Diamond's gone to the River Eden to take a piece of this sacred place for his next journey.
I've got two little containers here, and I'm going to go down to the Appleby River where the horses get washed and put some Appleby water in them. So I've always got Appleby with me.
When I come up here, it brings all the childhood memories back. My family, my father, my uncles. We've had some good times up here.
I'm just going to go behind my magic curtain, and here we go. I've got a lovely shirt picked out.
For his horse riding lesson, Diamond's determined to look the part.
You have to look your best. I like to be well turned out. Here we go. Da-da-da-da-da. There's my outfit today.
I hope it's not one of these little pony things, a child's horse. The white horse looks my favourite. I'll look like the Long Ranger on that. I old silver, that'll do me. If you're going to learn to drive, you need to learn to drive in a Ferrari, not in a Robin Reliant. I don't want that one there. I refuse to get on that one. You're going to make me look a twat.
In Redditch, travelling man Percy has pitched his caravan on a grassy verge by a country road in preparation for an important day out.
Hold it, then.
Percy's family are one of the few that still live a traditional traveller lifestyle, roaming from place to place, camping on roadside spots.
My family have been travellers right from the beginning, right through, like, you know what I mean? If I was in an house or on site, I wouldn't be a very happy person, tell you the truth, right?
Percy and his wife Rose have two daughters, 14-year-old Roseanne and 18-year-old Rachel, who've both left school and make the best of their unconventional lifestyle.
I've got to stay at home because my mum and dad look after me, and I don't think I'm ready to, like, move out or look after myself yet anyway, so until I find the right partner.
When you're on the road, Rachel, how do you meet, like, you know, your potential partner?
It can be anyone, as long as, like, I want them and stuff. Well, sometimes, like, I could meet them as in, like, they could come out and visit, or on the phone.
To keep costs low, the family hunt as much of their own food as possible.
Hunting for travellers is a tradition. It's something that's bred into us, you know. When we go hunting, just, I don't know what it is, it just makes us happy.
Living off the land and hunting with animals are well-established traditions in gypsy culture, with lurcher dogs and ferrets especially popular in assisting traveller hunts. But to make sure his prey has nowhere to hide, Percy's turning to his trusty hunting hawks.
This one's Coco. That's Red. And this one's Jess. Hey, come on.
What kind of things do you feed them?
Pheasant, rabbit, bits of beef, steak.
Percy lives hand to mouth, selling wreaths and wooden ornaments he makes from roadside materials. So catching his own food is a vital part of the family income.
But if I want to, they can keep me going, like, you know, in meat-wise. If I catch a pheasant or a partridge or a duck, you know, there's a couple of takers and I got a meal and I.
Before winter sets in, Percy desperately needs to stock the larder with food for the family and their animals.
The birds got to have meat. They have nothing else to eat, only meat. It is important, isn't it? Because it works about 30 quid a week, like, roughly, that's fair. So if I catch pheasants and rabbits and I boil them up for the dogs, some weeks I don't eat the dog food. They don't eat no dog food at all because they have plenty of meat.
So he's assembled a hunting team of Rachel and two gypsy friends, Kai and Neil.
It's important to go hunting because when we don't have money, get pheasants and pigeons and stuff like that, and squirrels.
What are we going to do, Rachel? You drive your horse down the lanes, and if I spot something, I say to Wolf, you just stop, and then I'll just release the bird, and better luck, the bird should be the catcher, catch whatever I release it on. Hopefully. Hey. Ready?
Rachel has the important job of keeping the horses at the right speed.
It's important to make my dad proud of me because he does do a lot for us and just got to make it up to him.
Go on, trot now, Rachel.
So Percy can keep lookout.
See, you see, well, if you see a pheasant or something, feel a rabbit out in the other side, yeah, you just let her go over them, but enough, you should catch it.
This traditional hunting method relies on acting fast before the prey find cover.
Looking in now, feeling you, because you might see a rabbit now. Eh? Whoa, slow down. Stop, Rachel, man. You got that side, Neil, and I say the same.
What have you seen?
A pheasant.
Hawks can spot their prey from 100 feet away and achieve dive speeds of over 100 miles an hour.
Anyway. Jess, yo. Jess, come on. I should have loosed the goal the first time, I should have. Come on.
So what happened?
Well, the pheasant went through the field that way, went into the wind, and the birds can't fly into the wind.
So far, the hunters have been outwitted.
It kind of is annoying when you don't catch anything. It is important to actually, like, get something because, like, we need it.
In Dorset, Marie and her brother Leon are preparing a special gypsy ritual to honour their dead parents by burning prized possessions.
When people die, you burn everything they got. So that's the way Romanies is, that's their culture.
And my dad made this years ago, and he'd make that for my mum to go out hawking wood. And we'll burn these for mother. And when she used to take these pegs around the houses, they'd last for years.
The ceremony is meant to keep a strong connection with the spirits of the departed.
Well, I'm gathering my family there for respect for my mum and dad. She will be looking down on us and treacherous, burning these bits and pieces.
But they're worried that it could be disrupted by local hostility.
Yeah. Remember? Yeah. That's what you get people like that about, you see what I mean? And you get people like that at night time, starving the horses, don't care about horses on the road or starving them. Then you'd get somebody probably like that in the middle of the night, come back, and then you get trouble from them.
Mm-hmm. They put worries to one side and start the ceremony.
I can't stop thinking about them. They'll always be part of my life to the day I die. They've done hell of a lot for the gypsy community. They've kept a lot of byways open by travelling, going back there year to year. They were just amazing. They'd be watching down on us.
Burning the handmade towels and pegs that help sustain Marie's parents' life is thought to ensure these prized possessions will remain with them forever in the afterlife.
Yeah. It's nice to all be together outside again, doing old traditional stuff, eh?
Yeah.
Just living their lifestyle, just for, even if it's only for a couple of days again.
Yeah. There was only just two of them, and they'd be sat around this fire now on our own to probably till the last coal goes out.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Well, we never forget him, eh, so you
know. No, that's right. I never forget him.
I can feel them. I feel that they'd be watching us, looking down on us. It'd make them feel so proud. I'm carrying on the old lifestyle, doing things that they done. It means a lot to me and my sister.
The ancient and emotional ritual celebrating the departed is done. The family hope it will now not be dishonoured by the actions of outsiders.
Leon, there's a car parked up here.
He's turning around.
You know what I mean.
Hi, Marie, are you getting
ready? He's back. He's turning around.
You see what I mean? This is what you get. This is what travellers get. And there you go. Now, what are they playing at?
We can't say it's going to be 100% safe. If
we'd
we said it was going to be 100% safe, we'd be lying.
Yeah.
You know, you're always checking your surroundings. It's just the way we are.
Coming up.
Whoa!
Percy's hawk gets a sight of the prey. And Rhino's hard graft masterclass gets serious. In Appleby, Diamond Jackson is beginning his bucket list horse riding lesson.
Left foot in your stirrup. And then one, two, three, swing your leg over. Super. Walk on.
Walk on.
Walk on, love.
Walk on.
Good boy, walk on. Have you trotted before?
Nope.
Trot on. Trot on. Excellent, well done.
Diamond's granddad, Snowy, was a leading horseman in Bradford's travelling community and worked as a stableman for the government, rebuilding Yorkshire's railways after the war. But for Diamond and many travellers in the 1960s, a wider availability of motor cars led them to embrace the modern age and swap saddle for steering wheel. Diamond straight in at the deep end on a powerful stallion.
And how do we get him to trot, though?
I'll show you. Push up and down, one, two. Just try and stand up out of your stirrups. That's it, good.
Is that how to ride a horse?
Yes.
That's going to be a bit complicated for me.
Good, go on, up and down.
How am I doing for the first turn?
Absolutely brilliant.
Good job. It's a bit of a balancing act being on a beast like that, but it understood me, I understood the horse. We was both in tune. Thank you.
Well done.
It's in your blood, isn't it?
Diamond's tamed the stallion and impressed his teacher.
So how come you've not ridden with Diamond?
Well, my family, they've all passed away who had horses, but it's on my bucket list. I thought, I'm going to just get back into the travelling culture, riding the horses, and it's something that I enjoy. It's quite pleasant. Yeah, when I'm up this area, I'll come in for another lesson.
Good. Bye. All right, then.
Bye.
See you, Diamond. Bye.
With his final bucket list item ticked off, Diamond's heading to the Appleby Hills to mark his final farewell with a traditional ceremony.
It's the freedom that you enjoy, the camping round a fire. And, you know, that's the enjoyment, the fire. And I can dance a little bit when I've had a bottle of wine or two, and I enjoy it. I have a good crack.
In Cambridgeshire.
Not just a pretty place.
Cage fighter Tony the Rhino Giles is teaching his son, Little Tony, to use a chainsaw to help instill a solid gypsy work ethic.
He goes round fast. When I was younger, I had to every day when I got up do something. Even on the weekend time, that's you have to pull your weight.
Rhino's bought the property as his son's inheritance. And now Little Tony has to prove he's ready for the responsibilities of manhood.
Hold that there. Look, that's it. Hold that there. Now, pull it back. That's it, pull it back. That's it. Now, hold it solid. Solid, firm, that's it. Solid. That's it, go on, user. That's it, hold it solid. Arms straight. Whoa, 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 whoa.
And he's done it.
Right. Thank you.
Before I picked that chainsaw up, I thought I was going to chop my leg off. Yeah.
Scary?
Very scary. But now, my dad told me how to do it. I think next time I'll be a bit more confident, do it myself.
How did he get on?
What? Good boy, Lo. Best thing is not to use one. But if ever you had to...
Bossy you are.
I'm not bossy.
Why?
Well, they're scary little.
No, you
because you've done that, do you want to have a little drive down the lane?
Tony's final task is another important rite of passage, driving his dad's £50,000 Range Rover on the rough private land.
Right, boy. Take time, yes. Take time. If he puts us in the ditch, he will not be driving no more.
As the highly expensive wheels start turning.
So go forward, go up onto the high grass. So I've got
there. Rhino will play the gentle role of nurturing instructor.
Bang! So now you're feeling like that little feeling to have a little bit more excitement. Go, just go that little bit more faster, ain't you?
Yeah.
Oh, go on, eh? Yeah. Stop! See, you didn't do it then, did you? What is wrong with your reflexes, son?
Because
what is wrong with your reflexes?
I have to stop.
Right, you go up on it. Up on there. And what is that's it? That's it. Take your time. Faster!
Is your dad a good teacher?
Oh yeah. Kind of when he don't try to blind me.
Little Tony survived the test drive, but has he passed his dad's grueling challenge?
My dad put me through a few tests today, and I hope I passed them all, really. I think I did a good job on all of them.
What would it mean to you to pass those tests and make your dad proud?
A lot, really. So I can show him I can do it myself. He's learnt me, I can learn. I'm like a man now, but he's telling me to be more of a man. Well, I've got nearly me driving down, so when the test comes, I'll pass that straight away. I've got a chainsaw down, I won't chop your leg off no more. I can get up the roof now, and bits up there.
I think you passed all of them, didn't you? Mm. All three today.
Well,
it's a little bit temperamental with a chainsaw. Driving was brilliant. If I know one thing, I'll be taking my keys everywhere I go from now on. He shares my clothes, he'll be taking my car soon.
Rhino's made vital steps in preparing his son's inheritance for renovation and taught little Tony essential gypsy life skills.
I'm really happy with him today. He's actually worked today. We've got stuff done. The fencing's going up. We've got a long way to go yet.
Showing him the true way to be a gypsy man.
Yes. We don't roll, we don't bend. We're travellers to the end. God bless you.
Redditch. Traveller Percy and his daughter Rachel are on an important hunting mission to catch food for their family and animals.
The more effort you put into something, the better things are going to work out, aren't they? Just never give up.
For gypsies, throughout the centuries, being self-sufficient has helped them live apart from the settled society they often mistrust. Percy is one of the few that maintains this tradition, living on the move in a roadside wagon with no regular income. So catching game is a vital source of food.
I live free and I think everything should be free.
When going hunting with my dad is important because we need the food for, like, to feed the birds.
Having had no success with the hawk, they've called him back up.
We're going to put a ferret in some holes and hopefully bolt a rabbit for the birds to catch.
What are the chances of catching some rabbits, would you say, today?
Well, if they come out, a really good chance, as long as they come out of the holes.
Along with their friend Neil, the hunt starts.
I know it's definitely wrapped those up out of Jane, isn't it? My roads are rich. Flaffert and Richard. Yeah.
Rachel sends the ferret in to flush out the rabbits.
Usually they're out by now, but nothing's gone right so far. The ferret's just having trouble finding them, so she'll find one now in a minute. There's got to be rabbits in there. You had the bird, see the bird? She heard a rabbit then.
Percy takes over with an old hunter's trick to confuse his prey. And before long,
go!
Jess swoops.
That was unlucky, wasn't it? I was one lucky rabbit, but usually she kill them like that.
The hunters are closing in.
Oh, the bird's gone that way now.
We were really close, but we didn't really get anything.
Having found the warren, Percy turns to his ferret. This time, there's no escape.
A lot of rabbits in the hole, and the ferrets is catching them, killing them.
The family are proud of their traditional method of survival, despite the views of some non-gypsies.
Other girls my age probably won't enjoy it, like, they get freaked out by, like, us killing the animals and stuff. So, yeah, they probably won't like it, but to me it's normal because it's my lifestyle.
What do you do with them?
Well, I feed the birds them.
Eventually, Percy and Rachel have a vital haul of food to feed the animals and save money for the family.
How many shishis you get today?
Two.
Two half of ones.
These rabbits, the rabbits are rabbits. It doesn't matter how big it is.
I bet I could do better than me for them myself.
Well, we've got bird food, we a load, like the feather caught them, not the birds, but we got something. It could have been, we could have come back empty-handed, couldn't we?
Even though we didn't catch that much, I still learned a lot, so it's still good. I like working on a team with my dad because it's quite, he isn't so bossy.
All this life where I live, it ain't about how much money, because you're never going to be rich. It's about being happy. It's about just earning enough money just to survive.
Coming up,
Van and the Calabar.
Marie and family have unexpected guests.
First, we heard a bit of banging, didn't we?
Yeah.
Then we went back and we heard other cars skidding up again. You guess from there, you're up all night.
And it's last orders for Diamond Jackson.
I'm going to get drunk like a traveller. They really do.
In Dorset, Marie and family are waking up.
So just showing how you found us this morning, Leo.
And it seems they had company overnight.
I mean, I put that in there this morning, but that was like that. That was just left like that, undone. And that was open like that.
Van and the catapult.
They just was looking for us. They obviously thought it was something in there, but maybe they was going to take the box. We don't know. But a four-wheel drive pulled up there, we come running up.
Yeah.
There was a bloke stood here.
Probably was going to take the box.
And when they see us, they took off.
Yeah.
You know?
We was minding our own business, you know? We was paying respect to my mum and dad, and you get all this abuse. It's not right.
Well, first, we heard a bit of banging, didn't we?
Yeah.
So there was cars skidding, there was a bit of banging going on. And we jumped up, time we got to them, they sped off. And then we went back and we heard other cars skidding up again. You just, from there, you're up all night. You know, you can't rest, you don't know what's going to happen.
Despite the disturbance, the family are glad to have paid tribute to their parents with the time-honoured traditions of their culture.
Yeah, all in all, it's been brilliant. Yeah, they all enjoyed it. You know, the kids enjoyed it. But we'd do it again. Bit sad, being a child brought up in the tent. Like last night, it brought some memories back, and I could almost feel them there, like, watching us. That was like letting them free, like, you know, letting it go.
They're with Jesus. I do know they're with Jesus, and I know they will be looking down on us and thinking, oh, look what my children have done for me. What a big special moment.
It was a peaceful life. I love the nature side of it, and when the wind gets up and the rain hitting on the caravan's roof, it used to put me asleep when I was a child. Mum used to tell us nighttime stories, just make stories up. And it was beautiful. Never forget it.
Was it the kind of perfect send-off for your parents?
Oh, yeah, yeah, they'd love us being out here. They'd want for we to keep it going. It's so gorgeous. Look at the view.
I know, it's lovely. It was beautiful out there.
I'd never change what I are, never. I don't think nobody should be ashamed of what you are. You're born a gypsy, you're born a gypsy, and you carry on being a gypsy.
In Appleby, Diamond Jackson has reached the end of his gypsy bucket list.
I just like being on the road. I'm free. I've nobody telling me what to do. I can pick my own place to stop. I can choose to do what I want, when I want, how I want. That's freedom.
He's come to a special place to contemplate what's past and what's to come.
I'm going to have a fire, a few chops and some wine. Just a nice small fire I'm going to have, just to cook my food. Nice big chops then. What a wonderful life, to be a proud travelling man. I hope there's more years to come of it, because I love it. Now I'm going to have a party, a few wines, a few beers too, and get drunk like a traveller. They really do. I'm just doing what my family have always done. My granddad Snowy and my grandma Jackson, they'll be up there thinking, I'm very proud of me. I'm keeping the flag flying. I'm the last one. I'm connected to my family. I'm connected to the land. I'm connected to the traveller's way of life.
Diamond's descended from a tough-as-nails travelling family of bare-knuckle fighters, scrappers and horsemen, story-sharers around many a campfire. Like them and countless others, Diamond's proud to have followed their ancient culture through thick and thin.
The traveller's life is the best life. You've got total freedom. It smells like roses. It tastes like honey, and it looks like heaven. Every day, I go to a different part of God's land. What a life, the traveller's life. Don't get no better than this. Happy days!
From their steak bakes to vegan sausage rolls, who can resist going inside Greg's, Britain's best bakery, brand new next Wednesday at 8? And tonight, it started as a rumour that went too far and saw an innocent man murdered by a mob. We examine the case, brand new next.